folks. I want to thank everybody for coming out. It's a great crowd, and we expect more people will roll in the next few minutes, hopefully without rolling over you. But we had to start close to 7 o'clock because we've got to clear the room for 8:30. So I'm grateful to people for turning up early, and as I say, we expect more people coming in. I'm Brian Kelly. I'm a member of the Belfast Working-Class History Group, and I teach history at Queen's. I want to welcome everybody and say a few words. I'm not going to do a long-winded introduction if you don't have the time, but I want to say a few words about who we are and why we organize this event tonight. Belfast Working-Class History Group, Cumann, Stair, Oibre, Belfast-based, organized late last year by lay and professional historians, labor, community, and youth activists concerned that alternative perspectives were absent from official commemorations in the decade of centenaries in Belfast. We reject the two traditions approach to understanding this city's troubled past, and we're critical of the way it's being deployed in the new post-agreement era to construct a highly sanitized, shared past in which dissenting voices are neglected or obscured, and opponents of the status quo marginalized and forgotten. In a city that remains deeply divided and one that is marked by high social deprivation on all sides, we're committed to promoting an inclusive, informed, and open-ended discussion about our past and about the present. We're critical of both the unionist and nationalist political traditions and of attempts to downplay Britain's responsibility for fomenting division in Ireland. And we'll lend our support to any efforts to bring working-class people together across the sectarian divide and across racial and ethnic boundaries. We're grateful that the Heritage Lottery Fund and the Community Relations Council saw something in this approach and decided to support us with funding. And we're also grateful to Queen's University Belfast School of History and Anthropology and the Institute for Collaborative Research in the Humanities, which have also been enthusiastic in their support for this project. We're grateful also for Creative Workers Cooperative, the people who you see around me doing the filming, who've done all the web design, the graphics design, produced the posters, and are now filming the tonight's panel and the rest of the series so that they can be put up on the web. This series of lectures and panel discussions, our first major undertaking, is aimed at drawing attention to the diverse sources of opposition to the First World War in Ireland, and to the relationship between the carnage of the war and the profound social upheaval that it detonated in Ireland, across Europe, and indeed among colonial subjects of the main powers right across the globe. And you can see in the program that's been left on your seats, the range of topics that we're going to try to discuss over the next week, or the next 8 weeks, including Asia and Africa and their place in the First World War, including the role of women in opposition to the war in Ireland, including talks on labor, on republicanism, on the city of Belfast, etc. Tonight's panel is titled Commemorating the Great War in an Age of Shock and Awe. So there's a problem about, always a problem about trying to remember the past, but particularly in an age which is reeks really of militarism. We're not operating in a wide open context here, but one in which much of the world, unfortunately, is dragged into war every few years. So that's the context in which tonight's discussion takes place. We've got 4 great speakers. Brian Hanley is well known to the audience in Belfast. With Scott Miller, he wrote the book The Lost Revolution, the main history, really, of the official Republican movement in this city, and has written numerous articles on republicanism, labor, radicalism in Ireland in the 20th century. Fergal McCluskey is a teacher at College of Feirste in West Belfast, the author of 2 books, one on Fenians and Ribbonmen in Ulster, the second on Tyrone and the Irish Revolution, both important books that people need to, should have a look at if you haven't already. Joe Law, also well known to activists in Belfast, longtime trade unionist, born and raised on the Shankill, trade unionist for most of his life, and active in the socialist and radical movement in this city for a long time.
And finally, Sally Campbell, who's the editor of Socialist Review in London, has come over to speak about British perspective on the First World War and opposition to the First World War. So I'm trying to keep them to 15 minutes each. I'm not going to say another word till we come around to the discussion. I will say this, though. I hope people can come along to the social in the dark horse that follows this. From 9 o'clock on, Barry Kerr, great local musician, will be playing music for us, and we'll get a chance to talk in a less formal setting. So I'll let Brian Hanley take it away. And thanks again for turning out tonight.
Thank you, Brian. I'm delighted I was asked to speak at this tonight. I want to thank the organisers for inviting me. At least 40,000 Irish men and women died as a result of the First World War. Thousands more were wounded, and families and communities across this country directly and deeply affected by the conflict. That alone makes it a hugely significant event in our history. Moreover, however, I think it's impossible to understand why the Easter Rising occurred and the way that the Irish Revolution developed without discussing the impact of the First World War. I agree with the historian John Borgonovo, who in his excellent study of Cork City in this period, The Dynamics of War and Revolution, argues that it was the First World War which really fundamentally changed Ireland in that era. In the last year, however, I think we've seen promotion of a kind of saccharine nostalgia about Irish participation in the slaughter of World War I. This is partly the influence of moves by the British establishment to recast the war as one involving the defence of democracy against Prussian militarism, with the strong suggestion that this was simply another form of the Nazism that Britain fought during the Second World War. And this, of course, has involved ignoring or downplaying the nature of the other Allied powers, including Belgium's brutal colonial record and Tsarist Russia's tyranny. Of course, in 1914, millions of imperial subjects across the globe found themselves at war without any consideration whatsoever of their views on the matter. A whole host of nations and peoples were bartered and exchanged as new states were simply carved into or out of existence. This was an imperial conflict. But as a historian, I don't have any difficulty with researching and discussing World War I or with its dead being remembered. I understand the very human desire of many to discover more about their ancestors' experiences. Furthermore, I think the conflict can be discussed, as a group in Belfast working on the Connacht Rangers have argued, without it being a contribution to the glorification of the senseless slaughter of the First World War. As far back as November 1934, the left-wing Republican Congress newspaper asserted that no Irishman objects to the commemoration of those who died in the Great War. But the question, of course, is what type of commemoration? In Ireland today, commemoration of the war, as Brian has mentioned, is seen by some as a tool for reconciliation, because the war involved Irishmen from North and South and from nationalist and unionist backgrounds. There are also, however, others who want to downplay or ignore Ireland's place in the British Empire and act as if there were some mandate for our participation in 1914-1918. And this is accompanied, I think, by a cynical attempt to convince us that the over 200,000 Irish people, and not all of them were men, who took part in the war, had been completely airbrushed from history in Southern Ireland, until, as the RTE website informed us, this year. This view, which reflects a more complex reality about remembrance and forgetting, plays again on the genuine interest of people in their family history and suggests that it was hidden from them, again, especially in Southern Ireland. In contrast, however, I would argue that the war was never forgotten in nationalist Ireland, but remembered largely as a waste of life and as a conflict that Irish people should not have taken part in. And that's the way I believe it should be remembered. Much of the contemporary commentary on the war is part of an effort to make us see it as something else. But the state that emerged in the 26 counties after 1921, whatever we may think of the Civil War or the pro and anti-treaty sides, emerged because of a rejection of empire, inspired to a great degree by revulsion at the war, which hugely discredited British rule in Ireland. Well before the conflict was over, people regretted that John Redmond, the Home Rule leader, had promised nationalist support for the war effort. As a song from 1915, first sung originally in Cork, I think, put it, "Full steam ahead," John Redmond said, "and everything is well, chum. Home rule will come when you are dead and buried out in Belgium." It was support for the war that fatally wounded Redmondism, not just the reaction to the Easter Rising. And much of the commemorative industry today, I think, presents Irish involvement as natural and almost apolitical. But Irishmen went to war in 1914 as part of the British military machine because of decisions made in London. There was no even partially independent Irish Parliament to rubber stamp our participation. If there had been, I think supporting the war would still have been wrong, But given that there wasn't even that fig leaf of democracy in Ireland, all discussion of this country's participation should at least reference this. And yes, Irishmen had served in the British military for generations. But what did this actually mean? A future president of the Irish Free State, Sean T. O'Kelly, I think explained it quite well to a meeting of Indian nationalists in New York in 1924 when he stated, "We must feel under deep obligation to work for India and for Egypt until both are free. We owe deep debt to these countries, for has it not been largely by the work of Irish brains and Irish brawn and muscle that these two ancient peoples have been beaten into subjection and have been so long oppressed? Our Indian friends could tell us many heart-rending stories of the brutalities practiced upon their peoples by regiments bearing names such as Connaught Rangers, Munster Fusiliers and Dublin Fusiliers. Until we Irish do something practical to make amends for the wrongdoing, that shame will rest with us. Irish participation in imperial service over the centuries is not something to be proud of or to be presented as natural or apolitical." Now, of course, it's tempting and satisfying in some ways to charge that John Redmond and, of course, Edward Carson were responsible for the deaths of thousands of Irish soldiers. But how many young volunteers in 1914 and 1915 were men like Tom Barry from Cork, who reflected later that, "I cannot plead that I went on the advice of John Redmond or any other politician, that if we fought for the British, we would secure home rule for Ireland. Nor can I say I understood what home rule meant. I was not influenced by the lurid appeal to save Belgium or small nations. I knew nothing about nations large or small. I went to war for no other reason than to see what war was like, to get a gun, to see new countries and feel a grown man." And I think, as Brian said, the lure of militarism, quite apart at times from the political atmosphere, is one that is still a huge challenge to those of us who oppose war in the 21st century. Similarly, the question of class. Over 2,000 members of the Irish Transport Union in Dublin joined up in 1914 and 1915. I don't think they went because John Redmond asked them to. They went for other reasons. And similarly, the influence of community and communal influence is also significant, not just here in the north, but also in the south. The Southern Protestant community, for example, joined up in very large numbers. However, it is true that many Irish veterans after 1918 were proud of their service, proud of what they and their friends had been through, and retained a sense of comradeship long after the war was over. But they didn't necessarily identify that with support for British policy in Ireland. Nationalist ex-servicemen in Cork, for instance, formed their own organisation in order to be independent of the British Legion. Their demonstrations were often stewarded by the Republican police, and in 1920, these servicemen were involved in bloody rioting against the British Army after one of their members was shot dead by troops. During July 1919, 2,000 to 3,000 members of the Irish Nationalist Veterans Association met in Dublin's Mansion House and called for a boycott of the city's victory parade. Mary Kettle, the widow of Home Rule MP Tom Kettle, who died on the Western Front, questioned why soldiers were asked to march past College Green, their own House of Parliament, where their rights were bartered away by the rule of coercion. And she also asked, "Did any Irish nationalist fight for any country except the country of his birth?" Cries of no, no. She hoped, in honour of her husband's memory, not a single Dublin Fusilier would march in the procession. If it had brought about an Irish settlement, they would march proudly. Such was not the case. But on the contrary, they were now asked to join and unite with the army of occupation. While Tom Kettle is often held up as emblematic of Irish nationalist sacrifice in the war, his widow's disillusion is less widely referenced. So how do we commemorate the war? In my opinion, remember with rage. Identify with those who opposed the war and predicted the horror that was coming. Point out the scale and nature of anti-war protests across Europe and look at that activity in Ireland. On the 10th of August 1914, the Irish Trade Union Congress and Labour Party warned that the working class will, as usual, supply the victims. Irish women, it is the sons you reared that will be sent to be mangled by shot and torn by shell. It is your fathers, husbands and brothers whose corpses will pave the way to glory for an empire that despises you. And the Congress urged resistance to the war. That sentiment was growing in Ireland well before the Easter Rising. In fact, this year we see the centenary of Gallipoli. Well, Gallipoli had the same impact in Dublin as the Somme had in Belfast, except in Dublin it inspired widespread opposition to the war. Similarly, wartime censorship and repressive legislation created resentment across the country. Deficit spending created massive inflation and led to demands for wage rises and hence the strikes. Ironically, wartime government arbitration actually encouraged the growth of trade unions. The Irish Transport Union was beginning to revive in 1915 as part of this process. On the land, rents increased and rising food prices hurt farm labourers, which encouraged them to join unions and take part in strikes. And popular involvement in movements like the People's Food Committees across Ireland in 1917 did much to radicalise opinion. By the time the British government finally attempted to introduce conscription, large sections of the population were in open defiance. And in Ireland, we can actually point to a concrete example of lives being saved by anti-war agitation, the anti-conscription strike of April 1918. Had conscription not been stopped, then at least several thousand more Irishmen would have died at the front. As even the Unionist Irish Times admitted, it was the voice of labour, not the voice of religion or politics, which yesterday stopped the wheels of industry. We think April 23rd will be chiefly remembered, not as the day when Nationalist Ireland proclaimed her spiritual and moral isolation, but as the day when Labour found itself. When we remember the war, this is one occasion that we should surely celebrate. Finally, I think we need to be prepared to critically discuss not just the politics of the war, but also the politics of those who opposed it. I think we should debate what Sinn Féin, the Irish Republican Brotherhood, and James Connolly and others thought about the war. The phrase in the proclamation about our gallant allies in Europe wasn't there to fill space. It was written in the belief that the Central Powers would win and that their reshaping of a new Europe would include an independent Ireland. This was, of course, a huge hostage to fortune and would haunt Sinn Féin as it sought admittance to the post-war peace conference at Versailles and also when De Valera toured the United States looking for recognition of the Republic in 1920. Similarly, if we can't get beyond reducing James Connolly's opinions in the war to the admittedly brilliant slogan, neither King nor Kaiser, then I think we're also doing him a disservice. Connolly's position on the war changed fairly rapidly from despair at the collapse of the European labour movements into support for their war efforts to not just support, but apologia, I would argue, for Imperial Germany. There is no doubt that from September 1914, James Connolly not only desired a German victory over Britain, which was a logical enough position, but also that he eulogised Germany as a modern progressive state and ignored or played down the reactionary nature of German imperialism, including that of its empire. In this, Connolly was allying himself not with the German anti-war left, but ironically with the pro-war right of the Social Democrats. A century on, I think we should surely be able to discuss all these things. Thank you.
I have my stopwatch going here for 15 minutes. So what I'm going to talk about generally is an appreciation of the absence of a critical awareness of imperialism within the commemoration of the war in Britain and in Ireland. And then from my own research, I'm going to try and use the tradition of Ulster republicanism and the anti-imperialism that was a major ideological component of it to try and come at the war and the war period from a different perspective. So whenever I was researching this, I looked particularly at Roger Casement, and in reading one of his essays, The Elsewhere Empire, I thought of the start of Noam Chomsky's book, Pirates and Emperors, where St. Augustine relates a story when Alexander the Great met a sea pirate, and he says, "How dare he molest the sea?" And the pirate responds, "How dare you molest the whole world? Because I do with a little ship only, I am called a thief. You, doing it with a great navy, are called an emperor." And this rang through whenever I read Casement's essay in 1914, The Elsewhere Empire. It said that Britain overran India by the same methods as had given her Ireland: wholesale plunder, treachery and deceit. Matt had her council board under a succession of governors and viceroys whose policy was that of Captain Kidd, himself a notable pirate. So I come at this from the perspective that hearing an awful lot about the commemoration of the First World War, I don't hear an awful lot about British imperialism. I hear a great amount of condemnation and justified condemnation of German imperialism. So for instance, when Michael Gove, I'm sure we'll hear plenty about Michael Gove later on, talks about the justification for British involvement in the war. He talks about the ruthless, his infamous article in the Daily Mail, where else, talks about the ruthless social Darwinism of the German elites, the pitiless approach they took to occupation, their aggressively expansionist war aims, and their scorn for the international order, all made resistance more than justified. And my argument would be that this is actually quite a neat encapsulation of the British imperial position in this period. And furthermore, that perhaps with the absence of public social Darwinism, this characterises a lot of Anglo-American imperialism up until the present day. So just talking about ruthless social Darwinism, Jeremy Paxman's took a great role in commemorating the war and commemorating Churchill. Recently, Churchill, member of the cabinet and the first vice president of the International Eugenics Congress, wrote to Asquith, the prime minister, in 1911, I think, and he says that the unnatural and increasingly rapid growth of the feeble-minded and insane classes, coupled as it is with a steady restriction amongst all the thrifty, energetic and superior stocks, constitutes a national and race danger which is impossible to exaggerate. So social Darwinism, eugenics were not the sole possession of the Germans. Regarding a pitiless occupation during the Second Boer War of 1889 to 1902, almost 28,000 Boer civilians died of wastage in concentration camps. We don't have a figure for black Africans who died because they weren't deemed important enough to enumerate. And then moving on towards Gove's refrain about international order and scorn for international order and expansionist war aims, Churchill again told the pre-war cabinet, "We the British are not a young people with innocent record and a scanty inheritance. We have engrossed to ourselves an altogether disproportionate share of wealth and traffic of the world. We have got all we want in territory and are claimed to be left in an unmolested enjoyment of vast and splendid possessions, mainly acquired by violence, largely maintained by force, often seems less reasonable to others than to us." So the idea that the war and the commemoration of the war has avoided these quite uncomfortable truths about the nature of British imperialism, I think, needs to be questioned and needs to be highlighted. Fortunately, in Britain, a lot of academic historians have challenged this. I'm thinking really of Richard Evans' criticism of Gove and Gove's idea that the war was justified because the Allies, Russia and included, were committed to defending the Western liberal order. So a strange sort of an argument. But what's more problematic about Irish history is that what's known as the Irish historical establishment, or a loose name like revisionism, seems to do is that rather than challenging the misuse of history in order to serve the needs of an elite and the status quo, Irish revisionism seems to be fully behind this revision of history to benefit the political status quo at the minute, and they come up with what I would call a very sanitised and uncomplicated form of reconciliation based around nationalist and unionist involvement in the First World War. And I would also argue that this isn't happening by chance, that this is actually part of something of an agenda. And David Fitzpatrick, who's a noted historian and perhaps the public face of the debate about revisionism in Ireland, has criticised the way that previous events in Irish history have been commemorated. He gave an article in a French magazine, and he criticised the commemoration of the famine, and he criticised the commemoration of 1916, and he particularly criticised the way that the 1798 rebellion was commemorated. And this is a very bad translation of the French. It says that the celebration of the 1798 rebellion was the best celebration of the revolt, ignoring the patriotism of the loyalists and the appalling atrocities against Orange Protestants. So essentially what my argument would be is that the historical establishment are not going to make the same mistake twice, and that matters have been taken in hand to guarantee that the commemoration of the First World War in the revolutionary period will produce a very sanitised public discourse on the commemoration. And this fits in with, and I've given previous talks about, what is an incredibly restrictive empiricist reading of history and a very conservative reading of history that is predominant in most of the universities in Ireland. So if we look at what Fitzpatrick has to say about the 1798 rebellion, so the anti-sectarian revolution and the deeply sectarian counter-revolution are as equivalent. They deserve equal treatment and equal esteem in terms of commemoration. And that brought to mind Trotsky's famous quote about such objectivity. He said, "The serious and critical reader will not want a treacherous impartiality which offers him a cup of conciliation with a well-settled poison of reactionary hate at the bottom, but a scientific conscientiousness which for its sympathies and antipathies, open and undisguised, seeks support in an honest study of the facts, a determination of their real connections, and exposure of the causal laws of their movement." So my argument would be is not that the nature of this revisionist argument about the First World War doesn't deserve to be heard. I don't think it can be painted as an objective and professional type of history that shouldn't be questioned, that there isn't an alternative to it, and that a materialist conception of this period or a Marxist analysis of the First World War is particularly legitimate. And when we analyse British involvement and Irish involvement on the side of the British Empire in the First World War, it is necessary to view this within the framework of a global imperial paradigm. So to that end, the nature of this type of conciliation is borne out by another Trinity scholar, John Horne, who wrote in the Irish Independent, rightly arguing that the 210,000 Irish soldiers and 49,000 war dead deserved attention and commemoration and respect. But he also wrote in an article in the Independent in May 2014 The rediscovery that more Catholics and nationalists than Ulster Unionists have fought in the war provided an obvious theme of reconciliation. Commemoration should facilitate the worthy search for themes of peace and reconciliation. He then looked forward to the commemoration of the 1916 rising, and he wrote that it is still not certain that there will be parity of esteem for these jostling histories, however much we might wish and work for this to be so. But he was clear that the time is well past when World War I can be seen as an imperialist war foisted on Ireland by an alien Britain. So here's what we have. We have a global catastrophe that led to the death of anything between 9 and 15 million people being used as a means of generating peace and reconciliation. We then have the idea that the Irish people who fought against the Irish Citizen Army and the Irish Volunteers during Easter week deserve parity of esteem and equal treatment. And that it is inconceivable to view the First World War as an imperialist war foisted on the ordinary people of Ireland. My argument is that he's quite entitled to make that argument, but that is not objective professional history, Cumann, that it's claimed. So, again, I'll look very quickly then on the grounds for this, in Belfast in particular, would seem a prime example of how this reconciliation theme should be addressed, because between September 1914 and January 1916, the Belfast recruiting area produced 28,000 recruits. So Belfast Catholics were four times as likely to enlist as Catholics from other parts of Ulster. So there would seem to be grounds for this shared sacrifice of orange and green. But if we actually look at the nature of this recruitment, taking aside what Brian has talked about, the economic necessity that generated an awful lot of recruitment, but if we look at the political nature of this recruitment, there was a dichotomy here between the aspirations of Irish National Volunteers, or Nationalists who followed Redmond's call, and the Ulster Unionists who followed the calls and the imperialist call of Kjarsson. And in fact, it came across a newspaper article from March 1915 where John Dillon, the deputy leader of the Irish Parliamentary Party, and a man who made very few recruitment speeches and wasn't keen that his own family actually recruited, he told an audience in Belfast Celtic Park that the Irish National Volunteer Force who entered the army would return an irresistible power at the back of the Irish Party in any struggle that might be forced upon them in the future. We will never consent, and I say it here in the face of you, to volunteers of Belfast who may yet have to make my words good, we shall never consent to divide this island or this nation. So the intrinsic logic of that statement is that the UVF and the Irish National Volunteers aren't going to the trenches as some sort of shared sacrifice of orange and green. Dillon is proposing that they go and recruit into the British Army so that they can fight the Ulster Volunteers when they come back to Ireland. So hardly grounds for ideas of shared sacrifice. But and I'll talk now very briefly about, but there was another tradition, and this is where my work leads, and that's the republicanism within Ulster and the people who stood against Irish involvement in the war. And it's very important, I believe, in this sense, to expose the fact that an awful lot of Irish people who recruited the British Army believed the propaganda that was generated by a million copies of the Brace Report and the poor attack on defensive little Catholic Belgium. But if we look at an Ulster Republican like Roger Casement, we can see that Belgium was not a defensive little Catholic country. Belgium was a major imperial power and a country that carried out a genocide of almost 10 million people in the Congo. And this is how Casement got his knighthood and earned his reputation, by exposing this here. And Casement himself, although again, he proposed international human liberation, but during the war, said it very, very definitely with the Germans. He said that England fights not to defend the neutrality of Belgium, not to destroy German militarism, but to retain, if need be, by involving the whole world war, her supreme and undisputed ownership of the seas. Now, the anti-imperial content of Irish republicanism and Ulster republicanism is challenged by revisionists who say that it's rhetorical. But I would argue that Casement's career before the First World War and an analysis of the grassroots Republican mobilisation demonstrates that it wasn't rhetorical, that there was a genuine anti-imperialism, and that Irish Republicans viewed the empire and viewed struggles of liberation across the empire as struggles that they should have some type of solidarity with and support. So Casement himself was a member of the Irish Volunteers. When he addressed the Irish Volunteer Force in Tyrone, which is the area that my study concentrates on, in May 1914, he wrote in his diary that he had preached nationalism versus imperialism yesterday to the hillside men of Tyrone. And at the Carrickmore speech, he said, "There the British carried a Bible in one hand and a rifle in the other. The only two people in the world who were not armed were the Indians and the Irish. It was rather a peculiar thing that both those were owned by the same master. That was a curious theory that one country could own another, but it was a theory of imperialism, a false, treasonable and irreligious doctrine. Now, this was not a novel message to Irish Republicans in this vicinity. In 1909, the Irish Republican Brotherhood cell in Dungannon had erected posters honouring Motilal Dhingra, an Indian nationalist who had executed a leading British official. The same year, the Oibre cell of the IRB had set aside some of its precious gun money to send to the Indian subcontinent to fund journalists who intent on fomenting education and harassing the British government in India. Within Belfast itself, there was a tradition of this anti-imperialism. The Dungannon Club founded here in this city in 1905. In their newspaper, The Republic, the regular contributor, Sourcefield, or PSO Hegarty, said, whereas Ireland today is no longer to be feared, the famine and the Times gang have done their work. She is only to be sneered at. It is now India where the danger lies. And he made common cause with Indian nationalism and Indian nationalists struggling against British imperialism, and recommended the Sinn Féin policy of passive resistance, quite presciently considering the future career of Gandhi, as a means by which Indian nationalists could challenge British imperialism. In the war itself, and this is the key difference, in my opinion, between constitutional nationalism and republicanism at the outbreak of the First World War, constitutional nationalism's and particularly the position of John Redmond is based on entrance into and collaboration with the British Empire. Redmond has a history of earlier support and sympathy for republicanism, but by 1914, I believe, and my argument would be, that Redmond wants access of the Catholic elite within Ireland into the Empire. So in 1913, he gives a speech, a Sympathetic Day speech in England, and he says that the only way that a Home Rule Ireland would attempt to interfere in any imperial question was by doing everything in our power to increase the strength and the glory of what will then be our empire at long last, and by standing in support of the empire the strong arms and brave hearts of Irish soldiers and Irish sailors to maintain the traditions of Irish valour in every part of the world. That is our ambition. At the same time, the newspaper, the Irish Republican Brotherhood, were saying that between Ireland and the British Empire and full freedom there is no middle course. An article entitled The Civilising of India, which was probably written by Caseman himself, it said that the English Empire lives on the taxes run from the starving millions of India, and Ireland is asked to become a loyal portion of the Empire. We may perhaps share in the spoils. We too might fatten on the Indian, the Egyptians and other subject races. Ireland, we are told, now will be loyal if she gets some concession, home rule or devolution, and will become part of the Empire of exploitation. There is little danger that Ireland will purchase a partial freedom at such price. We would rather remain a nation of political serfs than become a nation of imperial parasites. Better far for Ireland never to be free than to win freedom by joining in with the pirate empire, sharing in the guilt and the spoils of wholesale massacre and theft. There are other ways of obtaining freedom, and one of them is by joining hands with our Indian brothers, so that both they and we may be stronger to fight against British tyranny. So whenever the war breaks out and Redmond gives his speech at Wooden Bridge, Padraig Pearse says to the Irish volunteers, there are two paths. Irish volunteers, make your choice, for Ireland alone or for Ireland with the British Empire. And again in January 1914, in Irish Freedom, Caseman locates the Irish Republican struggle in opposition to the war within an international context. He says, for the voice of the Irish patriot was in truth a world voice, a summons to every audience, wherever men gather in the quest of freedom. So, and I'm quickly running out of time, and I was going to talk about, I'm out of time, Caseman's role in the Belgian Congo. But essentially, my point of view on the commemoration and what commemoration is that extra emphasis and attention should be given to the challenge to imperialism in the war and the people who champion genuine human liberation. I would also say that the Irish Revolution that followed the war did not succeed, and it has not been completed. The role of empire within the current neoliberal global hegemon also needs to be addressed, and the lessons from this period need to be learned. And as an historian, I would also view this period as a chance to analyse and to cast light on what I would describe as the false objectivity of revisionism. A lot of the claims of professional historiography in Ireland is that it's objective and value-free, when it is clearly not. But personally, the only kind of commemoration that makes sense to me reflects Paulo Freire's attitude towards history, where men and women transcend themselves looking at the past as a means of understanding more clearly what and who they are, so that they can more wisely build the future, thus complementing the greatest humanistic and historical task of the oppressed, to liberate themselves.
not a historian, so you'd be glad, maybe glad or not to hear that. So I'm going to talk about the understanding of the First World War from a personal background, from a personal development of looking at it from, not from what my community and some history that I read, because we all read different histories, but from a class perspective. So bear with me. It's important to know about who's talking to you. So I was born and reared in the bottom of Shankill Road, a very strong, loyalist, working class background. And I participated fully in that culture and activity from sort of the community, the church, the political ideology, the Orange Order, the whole sort of gambit. personal development was, I was always, from the day I started work, I joined a union. That was normal in my community. You joined a union. That was the first thing you did. And I was active most of my latter years of my life, not in the early days. I would class myself now as a socialist. That personal development come from some travel I was able to do. And I'll go on to opportunities for young people later on, because I think it's important. I joined the Merchant Navy as a young man in the 60s, and when we talk about oppression, I seen it at first hand, and it was because of the colour of people's skins. I travelled to South Africa, and I seen apartheid at its height. I seen how you could treat people just because they're different in the colour of their skin. I was called master. People stepped off the street to let me pass, and they were treated abominably. So you could become, and I've seen a lot of people on board and comrades, or colleagues of mine, wouldn't have been comrades, who become racist because it was easy. Or you could fight against that. So maybe when I'm talking about how you develop personally, that was a big shock to me. So I realised then that I'd have to think about how I, as a person, would make sure that sort of situation and another world, as a slogan we used in the trade union movement, another world is possible. So the First World War, it is a very personal thing for me. My grandfather died on the 1st of July, 1916, blew up apparently before he even left his trench. My mother was born a month before it, on the same day. So she had a father she didn't know. I had a grandfather I never knew. And when I look at what I was told about the war, you know, there was, it was, and what I had come to believe, it was a great war. My grandfather with others, and others meant broads. The others didn't go as far as I was concerned, or as far as I knew. We went. UVF, the 36th Ulster Division. And it was a great war. But the reality then is that, you know, if we look at it, and some of the historians will tell you, the idea of millions of people died, working class people. So history is skewed by your background and your community and by your education. And we do have two separate histories. I do a lot of work. I've certainly been involved in the trade union movement most of my life, working within communities. And it's quite amazing what history people learn, because we open the book, and or we maybe not even look at the book at all. Or we open it at different pages, agree with that chapter, oh, I'm not too sure about that. So here in a very divided society, history is very controversial. So I believed in my grandest sacrifice and the others was for freedom. From freedom from tyranny and slavery, if you like, because they, as Fergus said about, if you look at the jingoism that's gone through Britain at the minute, particularly that fella Gove, and he's like Thatcher, every time you mention her name you want to spit. And how that is obviously going to impact in this player. So the thing was, as I grew older, you have to think, well, what is true? What did happen? What was it about? Was it a fight for small nations? That I still meet people within communities who believe that. The little Belgium, as we've just been told what little Belgium's like. one of the greatest books you'll ever read, is at the back on that, and Belgium's role in Africa. So the commemorations were important to me, my family, my community. The wearing of poppy, the very important thing that you wore every year. When we remembered those events, it was from a very, as I said earlier, a very, very narrow perspective. It was our war, we fought it, and we maintained our Britishness, if you like. So the reality then, when you do start to read and start to look at it in a bit more, a different way. Well, it wasn't a great war, was it? Well, what war could be great as such? Those who died from the both communities were sold a pup, as we'd say in Belfast. Nationalists were told, all Ireland is round the corner, or home rule is round the corner, and the unionists were told, there were no home rule, go and fight for us. So why would people do that? Why did they still do it? Why do people fight those who they don't know for a country they have no stake in? And what did they return to? Not a land fit for heroes, but it returned to abject poverty. Women like my grandmother, my grandfather was older, he was 27 when he was killed. So my grandmother was left with 5 children. Can you imagine? In 1916, and we 2 up and 2 down the Shankar Road with 5 kids. We often called my grandmother a bit of a targe. I wonder why. She had to, on her own, raise those kids, working and cleaning and raising kids and whatever she had to do. So the more I looked at this, the more I sort of wanted to know. And I was the only one of my family ever went the battlefields, and I discovered, I went thinking I'd discover a headstone, but there was no headstone. His name's on the Thiefel Memorial, 72,000 other names. So there was nothing to bury, not a shoelace, not a boot, nothing there. So I discovered that, but when I discovered it and when I looked at it and I'd really become a bit more educated, you just get angry, you just get mad. That man went there. Now, why did he go? Was it patriotism, pure patriotism? It certainly was. There was a big push, because the song was a big push to finish it. And he enlisted in the Clifton Street Orange Hall and joined the Royal Irish Regiment. Or did he go for the shilling a day? Many went for that, a pair of boots. A lot of people did. So, not being a fight for a small nation, no one was saved from tyranny. It was a scramble, basically, for empire. And it was a scramble for who controlled Europe and who would have the biggest empire, who would control Africa and Asia and Middle East. So that's what it was about. A friend of mine talking about it one time in a talk, he said that what we call them, the robber barons of Europe, and that's what was about. But it was, as I say, interpretation was it was a patriotic thing to do. But when they returned, people who returned from both communities obviously returned to a different Ireland. With 1916 the rising, 1918 the election of Sinn Féin, when the election throughout Ireland. So it was a different Ireland to come back to. So, I've just lost my place. She just put these on. And it reminded me then, when you look at that, it always reminds me of quotes, and I like to quote some quotes. And Connolly said, I think about 1912, that when we led up from 1918, we went on then to partition. That was the answer for Ireland, escorting the Britons. And Connolly would call a partition a carnival of reaction. Well, I don't think any of us from that time to this time can deny that was one of the most poignant things ever said. Because we live in, now, today, 2 failed states. We live in a sectarian state, which is this one, was very much sectarian. Maybe it's changed a little bit now. Certainly governed in a sectarian way. And the other one was a confessional state, someone said. So I think you're quoting that from someone else. So when they returned, as we heard some of the talk, in the north, obviously, they returned as heroes. They were fated. They were, what wonderful thing they'd done. In the south, was a different sort of thing. I think maybe even some of them felt they were duped and it was sort of hidden. There's some sort of recognition now, and we talked about that, and how we recognise it in the south. But obviously, in this part of Ireland, it's a very, very big thing, the Somme and the remembrance of the Somme, as if the World War was just Somme. 4 years of war was sort of that Somme, even one day, actually, an interpretation of it. So 1916 is a very important year, and next year is going to be 100 anniversaries of that for the two traditions. So do we commemorate or celebrate? The present division, separation, proves that that's going to be difficult. Because in workplaces and communities, the ideas of identity are very, very strong. Just checking my mind. In workplaces, we still argue about the wearing of poppies. Some workplaces, there's arguments about, if they can wear a poppy, why can't I wear a lily? So those issues of identity are in workplaces and also in communities. So if we have, and certainly maybe the last 40 years anyway, there's some change, isn't there? We don't kill each as much as often as we did. And now we have Stormont, and we have a kind of, I don't know, what would you call it? A settlement? And but the other thing that has hit us in the last couple of years is this word, just 2 minutes, is this word austerity. And what's happening is that the economy is being robbed, actually. Being robbed. It's not austerity. This dismantling of all the things that we built, particularly after the Second World War, health service, care and benefits and all that, this is not about money. This is about ideology. And what I'm frightened of and what I see, our communities, the ones who suffered the most during the conflict, are now going to suffer the most in the economic downturn. We're going to lose 20,000 jobs. Somebody said to me, but it's voluntary redundancy. Whoopee. You know what I mean? 20,000 jobs, voluntary redundancy. So it's okay to lose 20,000 jobs in this wee place. And we have young people, I worry about, zero-hour contracts, short-term contracts, no pensions, no whatever, the things that we had. One statistic is very important, because this is important when we're looking at this, where we are today and how that's affected us. Sorry, Brian. Is that our young people now, for the first time in history that we know of, are going to be worse off than their parents in every aspect of their lives. Now, what that'll do, what will that breed within communities that have no connection with each other, who don't meet each other, don't see each other? Identity becomes the major issue. Your nationality, your identity, your flag, that becomes the issue. And when young men in those communities have no prospects and no future, what are they going to look to? We can see that happening today. So the spectre of sectarian division is still there, and this commemoration, celebrations or remembrance will not help, but also when people are lost and without hope and don't see any future. Okay.
I want to talk about how the British government has been using the centenary of the First World War and how I think we should actually be commemorating and what, if anything, we can celebrate in this centenary. Because when David Cameron started talking about the commemoration of the war, it was back in 2012, which of course was the year of the Olympics, the year of some jubilee for the Queen, which was a year where everything was about how celebrating the British spirit, as the Tories wanted to portray it. And this was exactly how Cameron talked about the First World War centenary. He talked about a commemoration that captures our national spirit in every corner of the country, from our schools and workplaces to our town halls and local communities. You know, the idea that he's even talking about a war that killed 20 million people in the context of a celebration of the Queen's rule or whatever, and of the Olympics is sickening. But actually, I think there has been a lot of challenge to the narrative that they're trying to put. I mean, I know a lot of people who work in schools who are teachers and so on. As soon as Michael Gove said that we should really stop teaching the war poets because they're not really representative of the experience in the trenches, a lot of teachers went out, and if it wasn't already on the curriculum, made sure it was, and made sure they had assemblies about the war poets and so on. You know, in local communities, like here, people are setting up local history groups, looking at war resistors, looking at conscientious objectors and so on. I know people involved in groups like that in York, in Chesterfield, in Derby, in, you know, in towns and cities around around Britain. But it's not just about history, as people have said. Cameron and Cove are trying to put, use the commemorations to talk about the world today. And this goes beyond them. A friend of mine who's involved in a campaign in Sheffield to save the libraries was occupying the town hall at about this time last year, and while they were there they came across some papers which included minutes of a previous council meeting, and this is the Labour-led council in Sheffield, where they'd had a discussion about the commemorations in that city for the centenary last August, and they talked about how it must be about boosting the image of the armed forces today, you know, using the slaughter of millions of people to boost our boys in Iraq or Afghanistan or, you know, and so on. But I think that Gove and Cameron have a real problem in trying to put across this narrative. So I will quote Gove again, because he was complaining a few months ago, saying it's important that we commemorate the conflict in the right way. The conflict has, for many, been seen through the fictional prism of dramas such as Oh, What a Lovely War, The Monocled Mutineer and Blackadder, as a misbegotten shambles, a series of catastrophic mistakes perpetrated by an out-of-touch elite. Yes, that is how it's been perceived by a lot of people. And I think that's still the general, kind of generally accepted view of a lot of people in Britain today. Cameron and Gove want to use the centenary to say we're all in it together. They want to try and bring together the message of the idea of a national war against tyranny, against German aggression, and use it to say, you know, we're all in it together today in Britain with austerity, we all have to tighten our belts and so on. I think that the dominant explanation for the war, which they're trying to push, you know, this idea that it was all about German belligerence, and that the First World War was a fight for democracy on the part of Britain, democracy and liberty, you know, someone already pointed out, you know, obviously it's why we're in an alliance with a dictatorship in Tsarist Russia at the time. Historians like Max Hastings, Gary Sheffield have been very vocally putting these kind of viewpoints, and Jeremy Paxman as well was given a programme on the BBC, and even though obviously he has been critical of the government's approach to the centenary, he still used his programme to take the opportunity to call war resistors and objectors cranks, you know, so this was his attitude to people who did resist the jingoism at the time. Now of course Germany was belligerent and so on, but as people have said, a complete novice in imperialism compared to Britain, which had already built an empire over 200 years that the German ruling class could only dream of. And I think that argument is quite clear for a lot of people to see, but one that we have to keep proving again and again, I think. Another popular explanation, which has come up in the last few years, we've seen represented through this book, The Sleepwalkers by Christopher Clark, which is a vast improvement on the other one. He rightly says that Germany wasn't the only aggressor. It's ridiculous to say this was anything but a battle between different imperial powers. But he also ends up, I think, letting the rulers off the hook in some ways, because he says that there were too many complexities to be able to point the finger. So he says that the outbreak of war was a tragedy, not a crime. The protagonists were sleepwalkers, blind to the reality of the horror they were about to bring into the world. But I think that the war was the result of decisions and actions taken quite consciously by the leaders of the European empires.
But nonetheless, they were driven into those decisions by the logic of the system that they were part of and that they pinned themselves to. And I think that the First World War could be and was absolutely predicted. I want to read you a quote from Friedrich Engels, the man who worked with Karl Marx. This was something he wrote in 1887. It was an introduction to a pamphlet which was about the arms race in Germany, I think, although I can't remember now. And I want to read it because I think it's quite remarkable how closely he describes the events that were going to come something like 25 years in the future. And so he envisaged a world war of an extent and violence hitherto undreamt of. 8 to 10 million soldiers will slaughter each other and devour the whole of Europe until they've stripped it barer than any swarm of locusts has ever done. The devastation of the 30 Years' War compressed into 3 or 4 years and spread over the whole continent. Famine, pestilence, general demoralisation both of armies and of the mass of the people produced by acute distress. Chaos in our trade, industry, commerce and credit, ending in general bankruptcy. Collapse of the old states to such an extent that crowns will roll on the pavements and there'll be nobody to pick them up. Absolute impossibility of foreseeing how this will all end and who will be the victors. Only one result absolutely certain: general exhaustion and the creation of the conditions for the final victory of the working class. This is the prospect when the system of mutual outbidding in armaments, taken to its final extreme, at last bears its inevitable fruits. This, my lords, princes and statesmen, is where, in your wisdom, you have brought old Europe. You know, and he's describing that because he's taking the logic of the system that is already growing around them, you know, the ramping up of colonialism around the globe, the way that the empires are rubbing up against each other. And it's very clear to see, if you want to see it, what's going to come. And I think, you know, talking of centenaries, I think it was last week we were celebrating 50 years of a world without Churchill. And to add to the quotes, this was from February 1915, so that's 6 months into the war. Churchill said, "I love this war. I know it's smashing and shattering the lives of thousands every moment, and yet I can't help it. I enjoy every second of it. You know, we are not all in it together. This is, you know, this was a war that was very much played out on class terms." You know, so it's absolutely, I think, what things like "Oh, what a lovely war" represent is that anger and that kind of class feeling that came out of the war. So one foot soldier who survived wrote after the war, "All officers above the rank of lieutenant colonel should have been strangled at birth." You know, I think a lot of people felt that, and that kind of came out of the war. Now, we're not all in it together, okay? We weren't then and we're not now. But it was also the case that then and now, too often, the kind of mainstream Labour leaders, with a big L and with a small L, bought into the jingoism and the, you know, the campaign to support the war. And so in the Labour Party in Britain, you saw Ramsay MacDonald, who was a pacifist, being deposed and replaced with Arthur Henderson, who was prepared to support the war and go out and campaign for it. And he was the one who went on to broker the deal in the national government, which took away the right to strike for workers. You saw Ben Tillett, the Dockers leader, speaking at army recruitment rallies around the country, telling tales of Germans bashing babies' brains out against walls, claiming to have seen the grease spots on the walls where they'd done this, you know, kind of whipping up the kind of hysteria that led to, you know, royal families changing their names, for example, that led to, you know, like a local pub near me used to be called the Prussian King or something, and now they changed its name to William IV. You know, all of these things because there were these kind of anti-German, you know, waves of hatred going on. And too much of the trade union labour leadership actually ended up demobilising, I think, their own side, you know, because obviously before the war started, there'd been a massive wave of struggles across Britain and elsewhere. The Great Unrest, the women's movement, the suffrage movement, and so on. But actually the leadership of those movements ended up supporting the war drive and sending those millions of men to the trenches. And it was a tragedy that life conditions were so poor for so many workers that, you know, it seemed like a break from the daily grind to go away to war. You know, so you saw the suffragette leaders, as I mentioned, Emmeline and Christabel Pankhurst, as soon as the war started, changed the name of their newspaper to Britannia. They started supporting the war, going around doing recruitment rallies, invented the white feathers to humiliate people who were unable to fight or refused to fight. But at the same time, you saw Sylvia Pankhurst, who was a socialist, who was active in East London in particular, organising among working women. And she continued to fight throughout the war as an anti-war campaigner. She produced newspapers and propaganda against the war effort, and criticising British imperialism. Other figures like Helen Crawford in Glasgow, who went on to lead the women's the rent strikes in 1915. And of course, one of the central figures was John McLean, also up in Glasgow, who organised factory gate meetings throughout the war and often with audiences of hundreds of people. You know, it wasn't that everyone was against the war who came to listen to him, but everyone was prepared to listen to his arguments and take them seriously. And he constantly would work with people to help them fight the economic consequences of the war on workers in the factories and the armaments factories and stuff. He would fight alongside them and keep putting anti-war arguments as he was there. So I think the key thing is that national unity was a myth, really. Of course, many, possibly most, supported the war, but there was always opposition, and this only grew as the war dragged on. Anti-war voices were in a minority to start with, so it was individuals in Britain, like McLean, like Sylvia Pankhurst, and the same in Germany, figures like Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, who were minority voices when the socialist movement across Europe collapsed really into the vast majority of it supporting their own governments against each other, each one accepting arguments about the other side being despots and, this was a war for democracy and so on. But it's their fight, I think, that created the possibility of linking together those kind of struggles that started to emerge, the strike movements, the rent strikes, the movements, marches for food and so on, connecting them to anti-imperialist internationalist arguments. And those possibilities really exploded onto the stage at particular moments, in Red Clydeside, in Glasgow, the Easter Rising, of course, and the pinnacle of it being the Russian Revolution in 1917 that really ended the war on the Eastern Front and then spread and inspired the mutinies that spread into a revolution in Germany, kind of really bringing the war to an end there as well. The role that socialists and anti-war activists played in that, even when they're in a minority, just by pushing through, I think is incredibly important and something that we have to keep bringing out and talking about during the commemorations today. So I think the final thing I want to look at is how we should commemorate the war. And I think it's worth going back to the people I was talking about at the beginning, and thinking about what is it that seems to make them angry when they talk about the First World War. What seems to make Paxman angry? Pacifists. What makes Michael Gove angry is school children reading Siegfried Sassoon. These people are angered by things that seem to challenge their narrative that they'd like to tell us. But I think the anger that we need to be conveying is about the remembering the horror and the waste of human life that the First World War represented. And I think one of the people who expressed this stuff best was Rosa Luxemburg, actually, who spent most of the war in prison for speaking out against the Kaiser in Germany. And she wrote just 6 weeks after the war had started in one of her most famous pamphlets, came known as the Junius pamphlet. And she wrote, "The cannon fodder that was loaded upon the trains in August and September is rotting on the battlefields of Belgium and the Vosges, while prophets are sprouting like weeds from the fields of the dead. Shamed, dishonoured, wading in blood and dripping with filth, thus capitalist society stands, as a roaring beast, as an orgy of anarchy, as a pestilential breath, devastating culture and humanity." Figures like her, figures like John McLean, who in 1918, towards the end of the war, was also up in front of a court trying to incite workers to refuse to fight in a war. And he similarly said, "I'm not here as the accused, I'm here as the accuser of capitalism, dripping with blood from head to foot." These are figures and these are words that I think we need to remember and recall. We need to be angry and still angry about what the system and what our rulers are prepared to send people out to do. But if there's anything that we can celebrate, it's that there was a generation of socialists, of anti-war activists, and ultimately of revolutionaries who continue to organise, who continue to argue, often from prison, often from incredibly difficult circumstances, and refuse to give in to the jingoism, the nationalism, and the attempt to, you know, divide people up. And I think that's the only thing that we can take from this war that we can celebrate.